Welcome you all for today's program from the Indians, that is IPS South Zone and NIMHANS Digital Initiative for Academics and Nurturing Skills. Now we have with us Dr. Dinakaran, who is Assistant Professor of Psychiatry in Mental Health Care Management Systems in NIMHANS. He has completed MD Psychiatry from NIMHANS in 2016 and he has also done his fellowship in Schizophrenia in 2017.
Hello everyone. Good afternoon from NIMHANS. I'm Dr. Dinakaran. So today we'll be discussing about the neuropsychiatric aspects of coronavirus infection and the use of psychotropic drugs during COVID-19 pandemic. The outline of my aspects of coronavirus infection, medicines used responsible dissemination of accurate information is the need of the hour. Based on these resources, there are around 600 to 700 publications that has come over the last 2.5 months in research journals, but hardly 7 to 10 publications only had dealt with neurology or mental health aspects of coronavirus infection. So the studies are very limited and mostly retrospective. So if there is a straight question that is the virus capable of invading the nervous system? Yes, just call the influenza viruses, respiratory viruses. Coronavirus is also a neurotropic virus. The spread can be through hematogenous system or axonal system, but proven transport through olfactory neural pathways are established. So once it invades the brain, what are the possible effects that the virus can have on brain? It can range from meningitis, encephalopathy, encephalitis to long-term sequelae, which is not usually studied because such neural invasion happen in severely ill people and they die most often. So the long-term sequelae is not very well studied, but it can happen secondary to immune alterations is what we know. So we have this one study from current COVID outbreak, which had shown that 36% of all inpatients had neurological manifestations. And the manifestations are differentiated into central nervous system, peripheral nervous system, and skeletomuscular. Central nervous system wise, dizziness, headache, delirium or altered sensorium, cerebrovascular accidents like ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic strokes have been reported. Peripheral nervous system wise, hypogeusia, reduced taste sensation and reduced smell perception has been reported with this virus. Skeletomuscular, apart from myalgia, there is significant muscle injury up to 12% of the individuals in patients who are severely ill and who are admitted. And also the doctors had researched and proven that the respiratory failure need not be just lung related. The virus can directly affect the medullary neurons in the brainstem, and because of that the death can happen. Because the death happens as soon as the patient gets admitted or within the first 7 days of such admission, and they have postulated that the direct neuronal invasion of the virus may be the reason for the death. So not when you see the all the organs that are involved, first it is a respiratory virus, so lungs are the most involved ones. Surprisingly, liver also equally involved as much as in kidney, which is the second leading cause of death, and cardiac causes of up to 23%. When you see the last slide, it is noted that 36% of inpatients had neurological manifestation. The problem is they are very poorly assessed, so that we don't have enough information about the neurological manifestation per se. So coming to mental health as such, there are hardly six articles which had given perspectives and viewpoints about the mental health crisis during pandemic. And what they have told is the mental health issues are poorly assessed and inadequately intervened. The assessment should be in four different aspects. The assessment should include general public, healthcare personnel who are not yet infected, people, mental health issues in people who are suspected to have infection, mental health issues in people with confirmed infection, and mental health in severely infected people who are admitted in hospital. But what information we have from China is, though the Chinese government has formed a task force, psychological task force, there has been poor coordination between the pulmonology or internal medicine team that is treating the patient. Between professionals, there is poor coordination. And because of that, the task force is not properly utilized, despite they have good task force in various hospitals in China. And because the internal medicine staff and other people assess and treat the psychological illness, there is lack of standard training in them, which leads to, again, poor assessment of the condition and inadequate intervention. So we have one study from this current COVID outbreak from China, which is an online survey done in general population in China. About 1,200 people had responded to this online survey. And out of these people who had responded, at least 54% had expressed a psychological impact because of this pandemic. 30% had reported anxiety symptoms and 18% had reported depressive symptoms. All these impacts are in moderate to severe category. And when they are asked that what did help them to reduce their anxiety, they have told that when the people are given with accurate health information and specific precautionary measures like hand washing, social distancing, such measures had reduced their anxiety to some extent. But that is the only report available from this pandemic. But secondary to the similar coronavirus pandemic in 2003, like SARS and MERS, we have further information about common psychological presentation during the acute phase of the illness. Symptoms, individual symptoms may be more common than the syndromes. Anxiety, fear, panic about infections, about death, about worries, about there is lack of treatment are the most common features that are noted during the acute phase. Sleep disturbances, poor concentration, depression are the other common features. We should be very careful about the sleep disturbances because it simply does not involve the physical health. Sleep disturbances, as we all know, plays a major role. If a person who is already mentally ill continues to have sleep disturbances 2 to 3 days, can worsen their course of the illness. So sleep disturbances, which is present in almost 50% of people who are infected with the virus, is a serious issue. And during convalescence, as expected, the post-trauma or living through the pandemic had created post-traumatic stress disorder, chronic fatigue, poor concentration and memory disturbances. And as noted, anxiety and depression were present in more than 1/5 of the population. So with respect to psychosis, we are aware that post-influenza pandemic, there was increase in a lot of new onset schizophrenia patients. Similarly, in 2009, there has been this study which is published in Schizophrenia Bulletin, which had shown that people with new onset schizophrenia, people with new onset psychotic mood disorders had exhibited high levels of IgG coronavirus antibodies when compared to healthy controls. So what are the factors that lead to this mental health issue? People are worried about family's health, people who are worried about financial distress, and we all are aware of the social isolation and its detrimental effects on mental health. More importantly, boredom. People, though are given leave, they are restricted to their place. They are not sure what to do during the available time. Stigma about the illness, stigma about people who are infected with the illness. And most importantly, uncertainty. When will this pandemic get over? When will medicine or vaccine be found? So such uncertainties lead to a lot of stress on the mental health of the individual. Media is a very good tool, including news as well as social media, to provide information, but they provide also information about other informations which are negative, like rumors and conspiracy theories, which again leads to a lot of stress on the mental health of the individual. With respect to quarantine, we had seen this morning that people who had reached our airports refused to quarantine themselves. There was a lot of fear of the facilities that are available, anger about being quarantined, acute stress, and you can hear people shouting, better kill us, don't quarantine us. So there has been reports and review about suicidal attempts that are made during quarantine time. So what are the steps that has to be taken to avoid such panic in quarantine? You should provide with the clear rationale of why this quarantine is necessary. And quarantine should not be more than necessary as set protocol about information of during quarantine, what are the things that has to be done should be given to the person. sufficient basic necessary supplies are to be kept along with the in the quarantine facilities. More importantly, invoking the altruistic efforts of the individual that they are doing something good to the community by quarantining themselves has to be emphasized to bring in a positive response from individuals who are quarantined. So what are the minimal requirements for mental health care during a pandemic? There should be appropriate assessment, reassurance and education works most often. Taking breaks from overwhelming information. As we see, every day we get multiple information in from various sources. Same news can be repeated multiple times. So taking break from overwhelming information, talking to close relatives, loved ones, availing professional help only when needed. These are the steps that has to be taken on an individual basis. So yeah, so the next question that we will be addressing is, what are the drugs that are used in coronavirus treatment and how are they going to affect the person who is mentally ill or who is taking psychotropic medication? There are broadly four groups of medicine that are used: antipyretics, anti-inflammatory. Most often the people are used paracetamol. European population use more of brufen. There is controversy recently, but WHO had clarified that brufen can be used. Aspirin is used more in Americas. The things that are to be taken care are gastritis, liver enzyme elevation, and kidney damage with respect to these agents. Coming to antivirals, oseltamivir or Tamiflu that has been used during the swine flu has been used most from the studies that are published during this pandemic, 36% of the time. But they come with psychiatric and cardiac side effects, as we know from their use during the swine flu pandemic. There is a lot of propensity to develop depression, delirium, and psychosis when oseltamivir is used. Ritonavir and lopinavir are recommended by most of the guidelines, but they are second most used during the pandemic. People should take care that all these antivirals have the capability to prolong QT interval in the electrocardiogram, which we'll discuss again. And remdesivir is a new drug that is emerging, which is again used, but to a little extent. Liver enzyme derangement is a serious concern with this antiviral drug. Coming to corticosteroids, it has been very clear that WHO does not recommend the use of corticosteroid. The use is controversial. However, people keep using it. Even the report suggests that in this current pandemic, 20 to 40% of individuals are treated with corticosteroids. The problem is it is associated with depression as well as psychosis. Chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, yes, they have very good evidence in severely ill, especially in people with pneumonia. It has been shown to reduce the viral load as well as improve the virus clearance. But again, the problem with chloroquine is it prolongs the QT interval. So antibiotics. Many antibiotics are used, but most commonly used are azithromycin and amoxicillin clavulanic acid. Azithromycin, among all the macrolides, more than erythromycin or other drugs, azithromycin does not have any enzyme inhibition property. It is one of the safe broad-spectrum antibiotics. Same with amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. The concerns are diarrhea, cardiac, and hepatic toxicity. So coming to the last part of my presentation, which is prescribing psychotropic medications during this pandemic and the precautions that should be taken. The general principles are symptomatic status of the patient has to be noted with respect to both psychiatric illness as well as the status of current COVID infection. People should be aware of the underlying organ damage. As we had discussed, any part of the body could be damaged, liver, kidney, because our medicines are going to get metabolized through these organs. So cardiac toxicity, liver toxicity, neurological involvement, those are the things that has to be taken care. Co-prescribed medications, as we had discussed, the four broad groups of medication, their interaction with the current psychotropics and toxicity. What is the current substance use status of the individual? People who have been regularly smoking, have they stopped smoking or have they increased to smoking because of the stress, increased alcohol because of the stress, current side effects which are there even before considering the newer drugs. People should be aware of what are the current side effects because of both psychotropic as well as COVID related medication, and make sure that the person, how much is the oral intake of the person and what is the hydration status of the person. So reassurance as a general principle in people, in general public, definitely helps. Proper education and reassurance is more than enough for people who are panicking in general public, for people who are psychiatrically ill but are currently uninfected with the virus, routine management or continuing the same medications is more than enough. Even in infected people, 80 of them are not going to be developing severe viral infection. So most of the time, continuing the existing prescription would be a choice. But in severely ill patient, there should be a cautious approach, case-by-case approach about whether you want to reduce the medicine, withhold the medicine for a few days, or completely stop the medicine, or change the medicine to a less side effect prone combination. That is what you have to take a call. Even for antivirals and other medication, WHO clearly says that assess and decide on case-by-case basis. So the similar approach all should be used for psychiatric medications as well. So with respect to new, the person was completely normal before but has new onset mental health concerns. If the person has subsyndromal anxiety, panic or depression, just reassurance and education about the illness, that this is the passing phase. Many are going through the same thing and people would come out of it eventually, is more than enough from a professional. If the person has disturbing insomnia, sleep hygiene practices should be, antidepressants can be used. But when a person during the pandemic develops a syndromal anxiety, syndromal depression or psychosis, please follow the standard guidelines that are used in the country. So if a person has pre-existing mental conditions and during the pandemic is maintaining well status quo, please continue the prescription, no need for any change. But if there is a worsening of symptoms during the pandemic, please make sure the routine things like adherence and sleep hygiene are practiced or not, because as we discussed, sleep disturbance is one of the common features even without infection. So that may worsen the course of the illness. So it can be handled with therapy, especially teletherapy, or minor dose adjustments that are as needed can be done. So with respect to four broad types of drugs that we use, with respect to benzodiazepines, low dose, short acting drugs are to be preferred. Care to be exhibited, especially in people who are elderly, who has respiratory distress, because this can add on to the respiratory distress and altered sensorium, which may worsen because of the benzodiazepine. Lorazepam, clonazepam may be preferred if needed. With respect to antidepressant, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors are preferred, especially escitalopram and sertraline. Caution to be taken regarding the GI symptoms these drugs have, though they are quite safe with respect to drug interaction. And with elderly people, hyponatremia has to be monitored. With respect to antipsychotics, sedation can worsen the respiratory distress the patient is having. And as we have discussed, antiviral, hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine all have propensity to prolong the QT, along with antipsychotic drugs which have propensity to prolong QT, can worsen cardiac issues and lead to arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death. Please be aware of the QT length of the patient when you are prescribing a new medicine or increasing the dose of antipsychotic. Individual drug interactions are to be accounted. Relatively safer drugs are aripiprazole, amisulpride and lurasidone, which do not involve much with QT system as well as sedation. Please assess the smoking status of the individual. They might have stopped the smoking suddenly because of the infection, because the smoking would have reduced the drug levels before. Since they have stopped smoking but they are continuing the same drug dose, there may be additive side effects which needs to be monitored. Coming to mood stabilizer, kidney injury and poor hydration can lead to lithium toxicity. We are all aware of this. So monitor lithium level, reduce it to the minimum dose possible. Valproate and carbamazepine have severe enzyme inducing and inhibiting properties, and they also have toxic hepatic injury. So along with virus, they can additively lead to hepatic toxicity. Other drugs like topiramate have poor concentration and leads to kidney injury, have to be used carefully. So to summarize, mental health issues are very common. Reassurance and education definitely helps. Follow the general principles of psychotropic prescriptions and be aware of organ damage and co-prescribed medicines along with psychotropic medicines.
Thank you, Dr. Dinakaran. Yeah. There are a few questions which have come up. Sure. What is the role of chloroquine in the treatment of COVID-19?
Yeah. So the chloroquine medicine, as we know, has been long used as the prophylactic agent in malaria, as well as the agent to be used in many antiviral treatment as well. But right now, WHO had not recommended chloroquine as a prophylactic agent during the current pandemic, but it can be used as an additive medicine definitely along with other antivirals in people who are severely ill, who are admitted in the hospital, especially people with lung infections and lung changes. Chloroquine has been noted to reduce the viral load and effectively clear the virus of the lung parenchyma, and this has been proven, and WHO had recommended it case by case basis, and even it has a good anti-inflammatory efficacy, and people with severe cough, myalgia, muscle injury, such people can definitely avail benefit from this medication.
There are a few more questions. Does SSRI or atypical antipsychotics have immunity enhancing and anti-infective properties also?
Okay. Very interesting question. Antipsychotics actually had mixed reports with respect to immunity improval actually, but has I am aware of reports that actually says antipsychotics reduces immunity secondary to sedation and increased salivation, those things that happen with the extrapyramidal side effects. So yeah, but whether antidepressants improve efficacy or improve immunity, I am not aware of any such studies.
Thank you. As via olfactory neural path, can it also get through eyes? Can the infection get through eyes?
Yes, the WHO had told not to take infection through eyes lightly. But people think that only respiratory route or through mouth is the important carrier. But WHO had clearly told during this pandemic, transmission through eyes are also quite prominent. Yes.
Is there any change in the rate of delirium in these patients?
No, it is less actually compared to SARS and MERS. So previous outbreaks like SARS and MERS, the reports of delirium were quite high. But with this current, there is around 8% altered sensorium is what is reported. And that's the only study that is available. Unfortunately, neurological observational studies are not very forthcoming during the outbreaks. But what people had told in those studies is there will definitely be something called as rippling effect, that when convalescence starts, there will be a lot of neurological manifestation and psychiatric manifestation that we will be able to notice once the convalescence starts.
Is there a relationship between immunity and like panic and anxiety, or worsening of respiratory symptoms by bronchospasm and hyperventilation from anxiety?
Yes. So we all are aware of the effects of stress on the human body. Whether people are infected or not, just the stress leads to activation of hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis, ultimately leads to release of corticosteroids. And corticosteroids, we know, lower the immune response. So there is high chance that stress precipitates infection. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Dinakaran. We now can move on to the next panelists.
Thank you, everyone.